Well, since this is a COVID concert, I don't have an engineer coming in to do the video, and I could be talking to nothing. I pressed the button, and I got a green indicator, which I could be broadcasting, I might not be broadcasting, and actually I'm broadcasting to the wrong microphone. So during this recital, I'll be jumping up and down, and I have a microphone for the piano, and then I have the actual voice microphone I'm using from the computer, because they don't work terribly well together, but individually they do a pretty decent job with their task, and the task of this microphone is to listen to me, and the task of that microphone is to listen to the piano. Right now we're listening to me, I think. So this program is, it's been, I guess, over a year since I've done an online program. This program is kind of a collection of things. And, you know, part of the benefit of that is that I can cover more pieces and different styles. And for instance, you know, there just isn't time to do complete versions of everything I'm playing. For instance, the Bach, the complete version would be 15 to 20 minutes. The Granados Goyescas, 40 minutes. The Beethoven Sonata, 20 minutes. The Brahms Sonata, 40 minutes. And the Albanus piece is from a collection of pieces called Iberia, which we'll talk about later. And that's, if you play the whole Iberia suite, that's about an 80-minute commitment. And you can do it in 20-minute chunks. But I'm just doing it in one, I'm doing one piece from the set, so the 12th of the set. And the last piece in the program is from the Hindemith Third Sonata, which is itself an 18-minute piece. So, you know, by just taking bits and pieces, I can cover different styles without losing my audience because I've gone on for too long. And I hope I don't talk for too long because that makes the program longer. But the first piece on the program is Bach. Bach is sometimes a good warm-up, and I'm sorry not to play the whole thing, but this is quite a lively way to sometimes to wake me up. So let me change the microphones, and we'll get started. Whoops. Thank you.
if you continued that work, you'd go into the Alamond and all the regular dances that are associated with the Bach Suites. Next on the program are two works from Goyescas by Granados, and the Goyescas represent, it is a suite of six related works by Granados. It's considered one of his greatest accomplishments for the piano, and it enjoyed very great success during his lifetime. And interestingly, you know, if I'm talking too much, just tell me so and I'll stop. I guess you can't talk back to me, can you? That's not too bad. But Granados made his living basically as a piano teacher. And I'm reminded, when I say that, I'm reminded of another famous piano composer who also made his living as a piano teacher, and Chopin. Chopin made his living not as a pianist and as a composer. You know, he wasn't making probably enough to live on from his compositions, but he made his living as a teacher. And a number of his students actually went on to edit, you know, be pianists in the norm, right? Actually, there's editions of Chopin's music by some of his students. I got off on Chopin. The Goyescas are inspired by the works of the great Spanish painter Goya, and of course Granados was, you know, a great Spanish composer, and so that just would make sense. And it's a very romantic work, and it does tell a story. And there's six movements. The first movement, which I'm playing, Los Requiebros, is loosely translated in my score as flatteries. And I'm not sure that would be a precise translation, but the idea, as I imagine it, the idea is boy meets girl, flatteries, you know, this beginning of something marvelous. And the whole relationship, you know, goes on for about 40 minutes and then it's over. But, I mean, it's a piece of music. And the next piece that I am going to play, Colloquio on La Rea, Conversation at the Window. This is a love song. So in the first movement, we have flatteries, boy meets girl. In the second, you know, there is this, balcony scene. And it's quite an interesting piece, very challenging to me, because it's episodic, and, you know, it's hard to hold together, it's hard to memorize, I guess I shouldn't say that. But there is a dialogue between a tenor and soprano, between the man and the woman, and the man has a guitar, which you'll hear in the piece. I think it should be quite obvious when he's playing his guitar. And of course, you know, that's like the stereotype. The piece goes on. The third movement, which I'm not playing today, is a fandango. And so they meet, they flatter one another, they fall in love, and then they dance one dance. They dance the fandango. And then the boy goes away somehow. And I don't know the exact story. And there probably is a story because of what I'm going to tell you. But he goes away, and the fourth piece is The Maiden and the Nightingale. And this is the most famous and well-known piece of the set. And in this piece, the woman is lamenting, you know, that her love has gone away, as young men do, you know, for, you know, different reasons. And so it's very sorrowful, full of sorrow. And at the end, there's a little bird, there's a little nightingale, and you hear the nightingale come in, and it's very clear when the nightingale comes in, it kind of cheers things up. The fifth movement, if I'm talking too much, just tell me so. Fifth movement is called Love and Death, and I haven't learned that movement yet, but I would like to. That's quite a large scale piece. And, you know, I always think of Woody Allen when I think of Love and, you know, it's sort of a, you know, evocative name. But I just recently discovered that there is a painting of Goya by the same title that apparently inspired this movement. And the last movement is simply an epilogue. And in each of the movements, it's interesting, Granados will quote thematic material from the previous pieces. So I'm not going to point that out because I'm only playing the first two pieces. So the second piece might do some quotes from the first one, but the big ballade, the Love and Death, you know, does quite a bit of a quotation from the earlier pieces. I've talked enough. Let me play it. And this is, I'll play the two without without a lecture in between. You know, this is the
I'm so sorry that I didn't change the microphones. I don't know how well you could hear my little lecture, but I forgot to change the microphone, so I apologize. Now let me change them back to the piano. I knew I was going to do something like that. Thank you. There, I remember to change the microphone. Just a beautiful piece, seldom played, overlooked in favor of Maiden and the Nightingale, and probably rightly so. The Maiden and the Nightingale has some of the, I used to make a list of the most wonderful piano moments, and one of them is in Maiden and the Nightingale. It's just marvelous, and some of them were in Beethoven and elsewhere. But what I was going to say about the Goyescas is that it was such a success. I love this. It was such a success that he was encouraged to make an opera out of it. And so he made a short opera, an hour-long opera. There are a number of such short operas. And it was premiered at the Met. And, oh, I hate to tell this story, but Granados had a lifelong fear of ocean travel. And they encouraged him that it would be so wonderful for his career to go and attend the premiere, and they would make such a fuss over it. And it was a very great success. It was such a great success that the President of the United States, Woodrow Wilson, invited him to the White House. But this meant that he had to spend an extra day in the United States, and so he had to rebook his return voyage. So he moved it one day later, and he went down to Washington, and he meets with Woodrow Wilson, and then he gets on the boat. And he ends up on the SS Sussex, which is torpedoed not too far, I think, from Spain, from his destination, and he drowns. And, you know, he was scared of water travel his whole life, and it finally got him. Sad story, but... But his works are just marvelous, and you can just see all the color. And the, it's interesting in Spanish music, and this is just about all Spanish music, and I'm thinking specifically of Albéniz, Granados, and Tafalla, that is highly ornamented. And the ornaments are extremely important because they're melodic, so they have to be clear. You can't just fluff them off, because all of them are. And that's how they accent notes. That's how they emphasize something. An ornament. You know, you put a turn on a note, and it's just interesting. And that, you know, that gives it part of its Spanish flair. The next piece is the Beethoven Sonata. Now for something completely different, like we're doing Monty Python. This sonata is an early sonata, and the Beethoven sonatas. And some of you may know that I'm in the middle of learning and recording the entire cycle. I'm more than halfway through. I've recorded this one before, but I'm resurrecting this. And in, you know, unlike any other genre, even the, well, you get it a little in the symphonies and in the string quartets, true, but, you know, you really get a sense of his development in the, over the years, and his artistic development, the development as an artist. The early sonatas are, he started out, he was a student of Haydn, and the early sonatas are Haydn-esque, except that they are on a much larger scale because the piano was developing at this time, and so they're much bigger works. You know, you couldn't, you know, they, I think the Haydn sonatas could be played on a harpsichord or a clavichord. You know, the pianos weren't particularly monumental, but the monumental pianos were coming, and Beethoven knew it, and it was coming during his lifetime. And so they're on a larger, you know, they have a larger scope. The early sonatas have just show tremendous humor, and it's like Haydn gave Beethoven his humor, and I don't think that's the way humor works. But this piece, the Opus 10, number 3, it's Sonata number 7 in D major, is a four-movement work, and each of the movements, with the exception of the slow movement, shows a fantastic sense of humor. It's just completely delightful, and the slow movement is completely different. Now for something completely different, and it's just riveting. And again, were I to add that, that's at least a 12-minute piece, and you know that would go on for quite a long time. But maybe we'll do that next time. But this is the first movement, and just in a delightful style. So Beethoven Sonata.
Oh, let me switch microphones. Ha! Almost forgot. I wish I had a studio engineer.
Thank you.
I can always think of more things to talk about. And with that piece, it's an interesting piece because it's early in Beethoven's career, and the piano develops during Beethoven's lifetime, and the harp is, the piano just grows by leaps and bounds, and he had less keyboard, and there's a lot of places in that piece that he wrote where he runs out of keyboard. He literally runs out of keyboard, so he has to jump down an octave. And sometimes I'm asked, well, why don't I just go ahead and play those since I have the notes? I don't have to jump down. But then I got to thinking about that, and if I go ahead and use the whole keyboard, like we imagine Beethoven would do, well, we don't know what Beethoven would do. If Beethoven had this instrument, he might not have written that sonata at all. He might have written something completely different. And who knows? Maybe he liked the idea of running out a keyboard. I mean, it's kind of fun. So the next work is the Brahms F minor sonata. And again, this is a 40-minute piece. And I could have played the whole thing, but I'm just picking out favorites. The first movement is quite interesting. This was this work was one of his early, very early works. He wrote in his early 20s, and Brahms had a very close association with the Schumanns, and he was really under their influence when he wrote this piece. And it's interesting to listen to this piece how completely orchestral this is. And we know from our knowledge of Brahms that he was the huge orchestral conductor, and the wonderful symphonies and the big orchestral works, and even the piano concertos are huge orchestral pieces. For instance, in contrast to the Chopin concertos, there's hardly anything going on at all in the orchestra. I mean, you could almost just play those without orchestra. Or the piano could just fill in a little bit of the orchestra because they're not doing much. But the Brahms concertos, they're orchestra pieces. This is an orchestra piece. He's thinking on a very big scale. In fact, in the development, there's a theme that comes in, and he says, play it like a cello, and it's in the cello range, and he's thinking orchestrally, and I'm always a little tickled by the fact that musicologists, or at least some musicologists, think that Brahms was intimidated by the Beethoven symphonies. And I think, how could you not be intimidated by that body of work, that huge body of work, those Beethoven symphonies? And, before Beethoven insisted that he was an artist. And before Beethoven, composers were artisans. They worked for rich people, and they were highly regarded, but, they were just employees. And so they, and even Bach, he worked for church. Well, I guess he had one of his jobs. He worked for the Lutheran church and for a lot of ecumenical masses and things. That was his job. But Beethoven just insisted that he was an artist. And so he was ahead of his time. And it was intimidating for composers that came later. And it wasn't until Brahms was in his, I believe, 61, that he wrote his first symphony. And so many of his piano works before then, particularly this work, are certainly, the first movement is completely different. It's not really orchestral. It could be played by orchestra, but, it's another love song. And you hear a more clear division between the male and the female, and the tenor and the soprano, and it's quite a lovely piece, very difficult to play, and I don't know whether I sell it or not, but I'm going to try. So this is first two movements of the Brahms F minor sonata. Thank you.
Thank you.
the wrong microphone on. That must have sounded terrible. I'm so sorry. I don't think I'll repeat it. I just can't do both things. But I fortunately I stopped. I told you I wouldn't stop, but I have a funny quote about the slow movement that I'm about to play, which is the Love Duet. And it's a beautiful piece. I mean, it just really, sometimes the intermezzo, this is the intermezzo movement, is played just by itself, you know, completely divorced from the rest of the sonata. And you'll see why. But Brahms puts a quotation from poetry. And I've been reading this biography of Rao, and Rao has an opinion about poetry. I thought that you might be amused by Rao's opinion of the poetry. And the poetry is by a man called Sternau. And the interviewer asks, points out, brings up this quotation in English. It goes, "Twilight comes, the moonlight shines, two hearts unite in love and embrace each other ecstatically." To which Claudio Rao has this to say, "Very much so. You know, Sir Sternau, the poet, was a mediocre, insignificant poet." A mediocre, insignificant poet. I don't know where Brahms dug this quotation up. With loving remembrance from Claudio Rao. So this is the intermezzo movement from the F minor sonata, and I'll change the microphones. I'm so sorry.
Thank you.
When I looked away, the software dinged, and I got a little warning. Of course, I couldn't read it. I can't read the computer even when I get close to it. It's just too little. I need it in the other room. I have a great big screen, but I can't read. I can't do anything on this computer. Anyway, so I guess it's still green. Somebody says bravo. What you hear at the end of that, you hear these great big rolled chords, and that becomes stereotypical of Brahms, and particularly a lot of his piano works. You know, you'll hear these big chords, thick chords, deep in the bass, and that's kind of a signature of Brahms. So I'm on the talking microphone, so I can continue. Oh, I have another quote here. The Albanus Iberia, here's the book, and there's four books just like this, and it adds up to about 80 minutes of music. And I've learned about half of them, to be honest, which is I'm very proud of. But Albacene, I just read what it says here. Albanus introduces us to Albacene, the gypsy section of Granada, perched on a hill, looking out at the Alhambra, which is the, I think it's the Moorish citadel, historical thing. I could be wrong. If I'm wrong, I'm sure somebody will text me. And you hear the irregular rhythms and guitar-like accompaniment of the gypsy with a delicate sixth degree of the scale. I'm not going to get into that. But what I hear in this piece is it opens up, and I'm hearing the hustle and bustle of the gypsy section. But I'm imagining, never having been there, that the citadel must be up, and you can probably see it, and it probably just, is a historical thing that just, I'm imagining, I've never been there, that the history of it just permeates. And, so you start out and you kind of have some hustle and bustle, and then you have a haunting little melody that comes in, and then you have some dancing. And so I'm imagining the citadel when people are looking up at the citadel and wondering what it was like, and getting this feeling from the citadel. But that theme, which I'm not remembering, I hope I remember when it comes down to it. Something like that. Keeps coming back, and he develops that theme in different ways, and there's a bold middle section where it's loud, and then there's a pensive ending section, and then you end back with the gypsies. So let me remember to set the piano microphone and see if I can play this one.
I hope this is... Thank you.
So my last piece is a piece by Hindemith. We take us, actually, I'm going to say take us into the 20th century, but the Albanus are 20th century pieces. I'm not sure about the Granados. I'd have to go to Wikipedia to find that out, but it's close. Hindemith was an interesting 20th century composer, and I believe an underappreciated. I think he'll have his comeuppance and will come back in favor, but right now he seems to be out of favor. And he's a traditional, in a way, he's part of the Germanic stream of composition, only fully 20th century. And Hindemith just has a unique style that's just identifiable, you know, from two notes. And I just love Hindemith. And what I'm going to play is the fourth movement of the third piano sonata, which is a fugue. Now, Hindemith was a master of composition, and he understood counterpoint better than most people, probably better than anyone I ever met, and I never met him. he just had so much fun with it. And this fugue is a double fugue. And if you look it up, if you look a double fugue up in Webster, the requirements are that there are two fugal expositions, and then the two fugal themes are integrated together. And I'll just show you the themes with the wrong microphone, but the opening theme, this is the first fugal theme. That's the first theme. And then the second theme, which comes four pages later. That's the second theme. And then he integrates those together. And it's just so joyous in a 20th century context. And in this, the symphonic works of Hindemith are, you know, if you see it on a program, you should go. Mathis d'Arbon, you know, I can go on and on. Symphony in E flat. And he made a point to write a sonata for just about every orchestral instrument. I could stand up without having my head cut off. For just about every instrumental instrument, for piano and the instrument. And coming up through school, I played an awful lot of them: clarinet, oboe, double bass. I can't think of the others, and they're just marvelous. And the reason, the thing that is so impressive, and French horn, the things that are so impressive is that he understands the instruments so well. For instance, the double bass, you know, if you think about piano and double bass, well, the piano is just going to overpower a double bass. And so he's written that sonata so that that doesn't happen. And that, you know, the piano will have solos, but then the piano is largely quiet, you know, is quite quiet when the double bass plays. And the trumpet sonata is very different. The piano can just play right up because the piano can't cover up a trumpet. For anybody who knows the Hindemith trumpet sonata, you know, that's just impossible. And a violin, it's very difficult for a piano to drown a violin, but a cello and a particularly double bass, you know, it's very easy to do. So I'll play this. This is my last piece in the program. This is the fugue from the sonata number 3, and maybe many of you remember this from my New York debut. Here we go. Let me change the microphone again. Thank you.
appear that I may be going a little bit into the red. I hope there's not too much distortion. I wouldn't know. I'm here and not listening on the internet. So that concludes the program. And of course, I did promise an encore. And for a lot of people, a piano recital is not a piano recital without Chopin. So I have a Chopin encore. And one of the things I think about with Chopin is, during Chopin's lifetime, Chopin, was considered a great pianist, but really only had a very limited number of concerts, and he was in poor health for a lot of his life, and didn't perform very much. And accounts from his performances that he played very, very lightly. He had a piano student, and as I mentioned before, Chopin made a living as a piano student. He had a piano student that came in and broke a string, a young man, and he just apologized profusely to Chopin. And Chopin said, "If I could break strings, I'd break every one of them. Don't feel bad." So it's just a fun story. I think about these musical get-togethers, and you really started having these. You used to have Schubertiades in Vienna, and in Chopin's time, they would get together, and Chopin was friends, although they had a stormy relationship from time to time, but were friends with Liszt, and they hung out, and Schumann, who was not local, so they didn't see Schumann a lot, who else? Well, I'm blanking on the others, but they would get together and they would play for one another. They would have salons, and there's paintings of these things. Everyone's all dressed up, and there's a piano, and people are ready to sip their wine or sipping their wine. I remember. But I always think that a lot of these, Chopin wrote a few large works. There's concertos, there's some sonatas, but the bulk of what he wrote are smaller pieces. And even the ballades are larger pieces, and they're only 10 minutes long. There's many collections of smaller pieces, mazurkas, preludes. And of course, the preludes are sometimes played in the set. And waltzes. And I'm going to play a waltz today. And so I think back, and I think, well, gee, what am I after here? I would like to play it in a way that was interesting enough that if I played it for one of their salons, I'd be invited back. So that's my goal. And I suppose I have to would also have to be able to carry a conversation and probably speak French, so I wouldn't get invited in the first place. But this is the A minor Chopin waltz. Thank you.
that's the end. I'm out of encores. If we do this again, maybe I'll have more encores. Maybe I have a zippy encore, but that kind of quiets things down, particularly after the Hindemith, which is it's quite a loud, kind of pokey kind of piece. So I thought that would calm things down. Well, thank you so much for coming. And if you would like to hear less talking, leave me a comment. You all have my email address. You could email me. If you'd like to hear more talking, I can talk all night. A lot of people don't like to hear me go on and on. But thank you so much for coming, and I will see you next time.